We live in a world of approximately 7 billion people. That means we live in a world of approximately 14 billion hands. Every day we face problem after problem, and in search for a helping hand, we forget how many there are. Some say our problems could be solved by someone we don't know, but how would we know if we don't talk to people we don't know, weren't our closest friends once strangers too? We isolate ourselves, piercing our eyes to our phone screens and our mouths sealed by fear of communication. We use iPods and iPads to replace I love yous. Losing the ability to look each other in the eye, we replace face-to-face conversations with half-faced pictures, FaceTimes, cropping out the true beauty of a connected conversation. I'm simply scared that technology will take over. Connectivity will fall to ashes. Isolation will take over. I'm scared because we're in a generation that cannot hold a conversation. Because we're blinded by the light of our Google Map destinations, we won't look left. We won't look right. Because we think the right path is only in the light of technology. And we won't realize we're looking the wrong way till Google says no available connections. Now ask a person for directions. I believe we need to connect and fix our world together. By not relying on the illusional web of social media to connect us, instead we can physically connect, inspire the people around us, and as a result, solve each other's problems. Over the summer, I spent a few weeks at the University of Columbia. Through this experience, I was inspired by a man. Let me introduce you to Maxwell Burton. Maxwell, I met at a bus stop, had a story to tell me. And I was so inspired by talking to this man I had never met before that I decided to share this with you today. For 18 years of his life, Maxwell was a skateboarding legend. His flips and tricks couldn't be challenged by anyone. He told me he dreamed of one day becoming a professional skateboarder. Yet unfortunately, one day, when Maxwell and his friends were just about to leave the skate park, Max said, and I quote, "Wait, just one more trick." That day, Maxwell lost his footing and suffered severe injuries. What touched me the most was that his dreams of being a professional skateboarder were definitely put on hold by just one more trick. He told me he was tempted to simply give up. I could see he was made for nothing else. So Maxwell went to college, then dropped out 2 months later because he had no more money. Then Maxwell, most of you may have had two or three jobs, while Maxwell has had 15. And he now drives taxis around New York and New Jersey. Yet despite hardships, he still has hopes of one day becoming a professional skateboarder. Now, I didn't read about Maxwell Burton through Google. I didn't stumble upon his digital profile on Facebook or even discover his inspiring Twitter page. The reality was I didn't need to read some article on BuzzFeed on how to overcome my challenges. I was given guidance by a man at a bus stop. He simply shared his story to me, and a door was opened up. Maxwell encouraged me to keep going when times got rough, to have dreams even when things weren't looking great, and he inspired me to follow my passion. Some of you may have had passions. The truth is, Maxwell gave me guidance even though I had never met him before. And we talked for approximately only 4 minutes and 40 seconds, and here I am telling you how much he changed my life. Go out in the world and find someone you can inspire, or someone that can inspire. You can inspire. I want to tell you today that technology we have, despite its intricacy, this world wide web, we are not truly connected. First on a global scale, then in our friendship and family groups, and finally in ourselves. To explain the global divide, I want to tell you a story. I'm taking you back to my year 8. Every day I sat beside a girl called Allison. Every day Ali stared at me. She swayed from side to side and leaned in as if she was trying to read through my soul or something. One day, after many, many embarrassing months, Allison decided to talk to me. "Where are you from?" she asked. Being of British nationality, I was confused. But accepting that my skin didn't look like her, so to her I must be a foreigner, I gave her the answer she wanted to hear. "My family's originally Nigerian," I said. You would never believe what she said next. Do you live near any lions? Do zebras just walk along the road in Nigeria? Can you take baby giraffes as pets? She went on. As you can expect, I decided to change seats because every day her strange questions made me so upset. But when I look back on it now, I know I can't blame her. As individuals of different backgrounds like ourselves, it was hard to connect, to understand each other. She believed Africa was simply wildlife because she had never been able to connect to an African's world, like many other people. And no matter how connected we think Snapchat world stories are making us, we're mistaken. Even the technology we see as the binding force is mistaken. I search Europe to find big buildings, bright lights, and even money. But when I search Africa, I find only safari. But I think to myself, there's more to Africa than just that. This just proves that we can't connect to another culture without physically trying to. But why do we need to connect? Take this beyond an African and a European. In the light of recent events, adapt this to any divide in our world today. Be it world nations, be it a personal conflict in your life, or even religions that just won't agree. The truth is, listening to the stories and voices of other people makes us more sympathetic, more understanding, and as a result, we can solve each other's conflicts. Every day our world faces conflicts. Every day you face conflicts with people in your lives. Have you ever stopped to think maybe it's because we just don't understand each other? It just might be that the answer to even world peace is simply communication. Now I want to tell you about the issue of connectivity in our families and friends. A few months ago, I went out for dinner with my family. We had ordered food and so we waited. Soon my brother started typing away at his phone. Then my sister, my cousin, my aunt, my uncle, and soon even myself. Suddenly I remembered to tell everyone about this exciting TEDx talk I was gonna do. So I broke free from my isolation, turned to my aunt and said, I completely forgot to tell you. In a few weeks, I'm going to the Brit school. You know how I... She wasn't paying attention. She was lost in the isolated world her phone created. So I stopped talking. Soon our food came. Then my cousin turns to me and goes, stop, don't eat. Let's take a picture. I smiled as my cousin and I were about to share a connected moment. To my astonishment, she shoves me off my seat, sits down, raises her arms and clicks. Would you believe she took a picture of my spaghetti instead of us? That was my second moment of realizing that connectivity had not only been affected in my world, but in my family, our families, the most connected community we have. But most importantly, this issue of connectivity affects you. Excessive use of phones means there's no need to develop skills of face-to-face communication. I want to introduce you to Dina. Dina suffers from severe social anxiety. Her mom always used to give her exercises on how to improve her communication. She'd tell her to say hello, wave goodbye, and when asked how are you, to tell the truth. Every time I saw little Dina, she did just that. Hello, goodbye, I'm not that great today. Not in that order, but yeah, she was improving. But one day, Dina got a phone. And when I asked, how are you? She simply shrugged. 1 in 6 people today will suffer from some form of social anxiety. This is much more than ever before. And the story with Dina proves that technology doesn't solve the problem. It only avoids it. So what happens tomorrow if it's all gone? Who do you turn to then? You may be the bridge. You may be the answer, and someone out there has the answer to your problems, but you will never know whose world you can change, or who can change your world if you don't talk to people around you. My challenge to you is this. Take 1 hour out of your day when you shut down all technology and just live. Take a walk with a family member to reconnect, and for your sake, do not worry about the Twitter updates you're missing out on when you're not online. Spend time thinking, verbally communicating, and developing you. Schedule coffee with that intimidating colleague. Talk to that guy at the bus stop. And by dropping our phones, smiling, and saying hello, we will be open to a world we didn't know. Finally, here's my piece titled When Aliens Hear About Our Technology. So my alien friend Angie asked me how many friends I have. So I said 10 really good friends. 9 I talk to all the time. 8 I can relate to. 7 surely. 6 I pray for every day. 5 remember when I came alive. 4 but trust me, it's more like 3. I'm sorry, 2. Angie, just one I really care about. But I'm not alone. I have over 700 friends on Facebook. So she asked, but how could these both be true? I had to tell her the truth. I could see on her face the contemplation, confusion. So I told her, social media is all an illusion. It paints a face over crying faces of exclusion. Bottles up complex emotions into frozen yellow faces we call emoticons, because we can't communicate to people anymore. But we notice signs. We know if people don't like our photos, they don't like us. So we run and hide undercover photos because they don't need to like the patterns we show on those. We can't explain our feelings anymore. So we need a device before we walk out the door. So prepare, Angie, device in hand. Block out the world with your favorite band. Can't look into eyes anymore, look to the floor. Anxiety rising in my body, scratch that in our world body. Can't rely on telling our problems to mommy, daddy, or society. So we upload posts onto social sites we know are run by the exact same society. You have to understand, Angie, we're just a world of paranoid people self-medicating on technology. But it makes me sad because we're in a generation that cannot hold a conversation because we're blinded by the light of our Google Map destinations, Angie. We won't look left, we won't look right, because we think the right path is only in the light of technology. And we won't realize we're looking the wrong way till Google says, no available connections. Now ask a person for directions. You may be the bridge, you may be the answer, and someone out there has the answer to your problems. But you will never know whose world you can change, or who can change your world, if you don't talk to people around you. Thank you.